Good morning, and welcome to worship here at First United Methodist Church of Monticello. My name is Brian Diffie, and I'm the senior pastor. Let me just say a word to those who are worshiping with us online. We are thankful that you have joined us, but we would like to know that you are here, so you can comment or check in on our Facebook page, and we also invite you to share this service with your friends. If you're present with us in the building, I ask that you fill out the attendance book that you see at the table in front of you. And as always, we have the cards over here to the side that you can sign before you leave this morning. We are continuing this morning our summer sermon series, I Believe, Now Tell Me Why. And during this sermon series, we're dealing with, well, why Christians believe what they do, and also how Christians in the Wesleyan Methodist theological family are just a little bit different from our brothers and sisters in the rest of God's family. So I encourage you to share this series and these ideas with your friends. But as we begin our time of worship this morning, will you pray with me? Holy Father of the risen and ascended Christ, you surround us with witnesses who have shown us the way. Inspire us with your Spirit to stop looking into the heavens and start doing the work of the kingdom. Help us to seek justice, becoming a people who nourish and clothe and lament. Help us to love kindness, becoming a people who forgive and accept forgiveness, a people who show mercy and live in charity. Help us to walk humbly with you, becoming a people whose secret identities melt away, revealing the Christ living within. Be with us this day as we lift our praises up to you, as we pray, as we sing, and as we worship. We pray all of this in the name of the one who has ascended into heaven, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. And now let us turn our attention to the worship of God as we stand and as we sing.
What are my words compared to yours? voice shakes the mountains, foundations of the earth. All I can offer is this fragile breath. With each one I'll praise you. With each one I'll praise you more. And I'll praise you more. And I'll praise you
As we move into a time of prayer and celebration, I want to first of all invite our online community to add any prayer concerns or celebrations to the comments section of this video. Our prayer team gets together every week and we pray over all the names. We have a GroupMe that we literally have a running list all the time. And so when you're messaging us and letting us know what's going on in your lives, we are praying. We are stopping what we are doing any time of night and we are praying. And so we implore you to let us know what's going on in your lives so that we can share your burdens with you. If you need to email us, you can email us anytime. prayer@fumcmonticello.org. Call Brother Brian, call me, let us know what's going on. We are here for you. Wednesday was awesome. If you met us bowling at the bowling alley, you had a great time. We had lots of pizza, we had lots of cake, we got to sing to Stephen. We had intergenerational bowling. It was so much fun, and so thank you for coming. We will do it again. There's talk of doing it as a back-to-school fund, but we will definitely do it to end our school years. For sure. It was just so much fun. So thank y'all for coming. Our mobile food distribution yesterday was awesome. Thank you to the team that came Friday to unload the truck. Yesterday, 9 of us gave out 200 boxes of food, watermelon, coconut water, and sweet potatoes. There's a few sweet potatoes left. They were football size. So if you're interested, help yourself. They are outside on the south lawn by the air conditioning units. It's Memorial Day weekend, which usually means youth group doesn't meet, but you know us, we like to play. So youth group, we're meeting tonight, 5:30 to 8. We're going to go out to eat at 6 and come back and play because it's always fun to have fellowship together. This week is Arkansas Annual Conference. Brother Brian and myself, Leanne Birch and Julie Smith are going to represent our church. Maggie Brown and Sydney Fallon are representing our district. Helen Gunter's on a conference committee, so she'll be there. Our sweet Audria works for our district superintendent, so she'll be there. Keep us all in your prayers as we seek to listen to the Spirit and do things to help and to improve the Arkansas Annual Conference. We'll be back on Saturday, but you all know we're always available by cell phone, so do not feel bad about texting us, because sometimes we just need a little get out of the meeting for a little bit. Right, Brian? Amen, right? Always a good idea. Vacation Bible School, you've heard us talking about it. We even had some people yesterday driving through the mobile distribution. When's Bible School? June 6th through 10th. It's going to be a great week, 9 a.m. to noon. We need your help. We need your kids. Come and be a part of it. Mark your calendar for Saturday, June 11th. That is the day Bible School ends. We're going to do a church cleanup. We've got to get rid of the rest of the concrete out in our lot right over here. We've got some potholes we need to fill in, maybe do a little pressure spraying. We've got stuff inside we need to get rid of. We need your help. 8 a.m., we're going to meet here. We'll let you know what you need to bring. We'll serve lunch. So come. Any age is invited to come and help us because we need everybody. All hands on deck. I want to invite Belinda to come up for a moment. She's going to talk a little bit about soul purpose. Y'all have been watching the boards. Thank you to those of you that have given already.
Is this okay? I want to tell you a little bit about where we are with soul purpose this year. You know, we put the boards over here, the donation boards. It's a little early this year because last year we learned that we couldn't find shoes and coats when we waited toward the end of the summer. It was just another thing the pandemic had affected, and so we really struggled in getting those. So this year we're starting early, so we invite you to take one of these envelopes so we can start purchasing the items we need. But we have another resource and another blessing, and that's our local schools. Although we take the coats to those children in schools, a lot of children in schools lose their coats. Every year, we contact the schools and we say, if you have any coats left over at the end of the school year, we'll take them and we'll wash them and we'll recycle them. We'll give them back to children again. And so that's what we've done. We've done that enough now that the schools contact us and they say, we've got bags of coats for you. We've tried to get the kids to pick them up. We've called parents. No one gets them. If you want them, they're yours. So in the past, we've done that. And in the past, there have been like 4 or 5 people in the congregation that take those coats and wash them. And then we hang them up and we share them. This year, these are our coats. We have a lot of coats to wash. This year, we need help. I want to say thank you to Renee, because Renee came up here with me Friday, and she and I emptied out all these bags of coats and went through and took out most of the rocks and stuff that were in their pockets. And we went through and kind of sorted them through. But if you feel led to pick up a bag of coats or two bags of coats, or however many you want, and would wash them and bring them back and put them here or put them in the preschool, that would be so appreciated. If you do that, please mark on there, these are washed with a piece of masking tape or something, because we sure don't want to be washing them twice. But as you can see, we've been blessed. We just need help in getting those done. So I please ask you to pick up a bag when you leave today, wash them, and bring them back. Thank you.
Thanks, Belinda. I'm already being asked about the rummage sale, and I hope you saw the newsletter. If you didn't, let me tell you, June the 26th is a Sunday. Immediately after early worship, we will start accepting rummage. June 26th through the 29th, that's Sunday to Wednesday, you have the opportunity to bring us what you would like. If it's too heavy for you, let us know and we'll come get it. But otherwise, let us know you're coming or just buzz the buzzer. We're going to be working in here that whole week. That Friday, the sale will be open to the public. But as in years past, we invite our church family, to come anytime, Sunday to Wednesday and Thursday, and shop. All we ask is that you just leave a donation, because things won't be priced until Thursday. Friday, we're opening it up to the public. I'm going to give you a sneak peek, and if you're online, you're going to hear this. But that Saturday will be free day. If you remember last summer, because of COVID, we had a free clothing, shoes, backpack giveaway just in time for school. We're going to do that again, but that'll be on Saturday. And so people that come Friday, that's the big sale, and then Saturday will be take everything for free. On June the 9th at 6 o'clock, there will be a prayer service for victims of gun violence at First Presbyterian. There will be scripture readings, a message, special music, and candle lighting. We invite you to come. Don't forget about the Hope Place baby bottles. We've got several church family members that are having surgery this week, and we want to continue to pray for all of you if you have tests this week or appointments. We want to continue praying for Dave Wilkins. Dave's in Baptist Hospital. He's still in the ICU. He's had an up and down week, and for those of you that have had heart surgery, you know what it takes to recover. He had triple bypass, and he's doing well. But still, it's a very hard week. And so keep him in your prayers as we hope that he goes to a regular room soon. Prayers for Charlie Abernathy, who is continuing to do well after his double lung transplant. Herbert Darden is Ginger Wilkins' brother. He's in the hospital as well with heart problems. And we are so thankful that our own Ruth Langley was in the hospital this week, but she is back home and she's doing well. But she would love to hear from you, so holler at her, text her. If she's up for it, go by and see her, okay, and let her know that we are keeping her in our prayers. Friends, we want to offer Christian sympathy to something that I know has touched all of us this week, and that's the family of those 19 children and the two teachers that died in Uvalde, Texas. How do we keep our children safe at school? We're hoping that here in Monticello, we can find a way that we can do that in our own community. Come talk to us. Let's talk about what we can do. Maybe be a bigger presence on the school campuses as they will allow us. But what can we do? Rather than just praying for these people, praying for gun violence, let's do more. Let's be more. As Methodists, we are called to do no harm. And so how can we help do no harm? Are there other prayer concerns that I have failed to mention? Then friends, let us go to God in prayer. Most gracious and loving God, in your mercy, you know our fears, anger, and doubts. We remember once again, God, that you tell us that when the waters feel too deep and the fire seems too real around us, you are there. You assure us that we are precious in your sight and that you love us. Today, as we remember on this Memorial Day weekend, your servants who have gone before us, remembering with gratitude their courage and strength. God, help us to remember the sacrifices bravely made in which one has given life for another and for all. Help us to remember those that stand in the breach where there is trouble and in which conflict threatens to undo your good creation. God, as we honor the past, help us dream of a future of love and peace. Peace in our homes, peace in our schools, peace in our classrooms, peace in your world. Comfort us in our sorrow. Strengthen us for the journey of life we travel, unique to each one of us. Guide us on the path of justice, justice for all people. Help us live as your people that others may see and remember Jesus living within us. Help us to draw on that love and strength that we may rise up. And through your mighty acts of love, we offer your light, your justice, and your grace in this hurting world. We praise your name and join together in the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I want to invite Carmen and Caden to come up. We talk about what it means to give, and so we invite you to give of your resources, knowing that what you're giving is going to go back to the work of God. No gift is too small. Let's pray. Gracious God, bless the gifts. Bless the giver, God. Use these gifts for your kingdom. Multiply them in Jesus' name. Amen.
So very much. That was beautiful. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, your ascended Son promised the gift of the Holy Spirit. So we pray that you will send your Spirit of revelation and wisdom that we may witness your grace and forgiveness, freedom and hope, joy and salvation. Open our minds to understand your will so that when sin cripples our hope, we may discover the freedom of your forgiveness. When suffering and death overtake our lives, we may know the joy of the risen Christ. And when we feel abandoned, we may comprehend the power of the promised Spirit. In the name of Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading comes out of Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 9. Hear what Paul says to the Ephesian church and hear what God says to us today. You are saved by God's grace because of your faith. This salvation is God's gift. It's not something you possessed. It's not something you did that you can be proud of. My friends, this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. It was many years of anticipation and effort that had gone into this one particular event. Ron and Susan of Minneapolis were finally going to be able to adopt a child. So an aircraft from South Korea landed in Minneapolis at the international airport, and the couple paced as they watched the plane. They anticipated the moment that they would see the child that they had dreamed about, that they had prayed about, that they had gone through extreme efforts to have as a part of their family. And when the passengers unloaded, they saw the tiny face of this girl among them. And the girl had been prepared by the adoption agency to recognize her parents. And she looked at the picture in her hand and she gazed out into the faces of the people that were there. And she saw them. And she ran to them. And she spoke these words, "Daddy, Mommy." And the parents had a picture too. And like the little girl, they had been preparing for this meeting. And though the parents and the child had never truly met, they had already begun the process of knowing one another. They had gone through the process of that moment when they could greet one another for the first time. You know what this adoption agency did for this couple and this little girl is not unlike what God does for us in salvation. He prepares the way. He prepares the way for us. Now, theologians would call this prevenient grace, the grace that comes before, the grace that comes to us before we even know who God is. God is preparing a way for us, the same way that this adoption agency prepared both the parents and the child. God goes before us, before we have ever known God, and before we ever meet God in conversion. It's the love God extends to people to show He wants to save everyone, all of us. Some Christians have trouble accepting this idea of grace. They think that they have to earn God's love. We get into that trap where we have to earn things, so we think we have to earn God's love. We have to be good enough. We don't do the right things. We don't say the right words. And so we keep ourselves distant from God because we don't feel ourselves worthy. Even the great hymn writer who helped found Methodism, Charles Wesley, had trouble with this concept. Charles Wesley was seriously ill when Peter Bowler, a missionary and a preacher, visited him. And during their conversation, Bowler asked Wesley what hope he had for being saved. Wesley replied, "I've done my best to serve God." Bowler said nothing. He just shook his head and laughed. And later, Wesley reflected, "I thought his response was quite unkind, as though my best efforts were not good enough to hope to be saved. If all that I had done is not enough to be saved, I have nothing to trust in. Wesley eventually came to realize that spiritual success in life could not be measured by the categories of being good or being bad. Salvation depends entirely on God's desire to build a relationship with us. The good news is that He decided to love us long before we became either good people or too bad for Him to forgive. God's grace precedes and actually enables our decision to accept Him and accept that love that He has for us. This has been a hard concept to grasp. That's because common sense tells us that love is something to be earned. But Charles's brother, John, was not immune to this pattern of thought either. For some 15 years, John lived through the frustration of trying to please God, doing enough, praying enough, serving enough, and everything he did, he found could not fill that void that he felt. He was frustrated trying to please God by establishing his own terms for salvation. And that's what he was doing. He was not accepting God's salvation. He was accepting the terms upon which he believed God would save him. He was sincere. He was devoted. And John only intensified his broken relationship with God. Neither John nor Charles were conscious of any desire to disobey God. Quite the opposite. But they were trying to set the terms of their relationship with God. And we can be right with God only when we accept God for who God is, our Creator, our Lord, our Savior. We cannot experience a loving relationship with God if we try to tell God how He will be our God. I mean, think about that. We cannot experience a loving relationship with God if we try to tell Him how He will be our God. Salvation does not start with us. Without God's prior decision to love us, we would not even care about our relationship with the Lord. God chose to love us, and He refused to let our relationship with Him remain broken. The death and resurrection of Jesus was God's definitive statement that He would never stop loving us and provide for us a way to be made right and to be made whole again. Because of God's prevenient grace, because of God's grace that goes before us, we can be made right with Him through trusting Christ as our hope and our salvation. In Ephesians, Paul describes the way God chose to restore people to a right relationship with Himself. God has predestined that all who are saved, and the invitation extends to all people, will be saved by trusting in Christ. God determined how we are to be saved, not who will or who will not be saved. That's an important distinction. God does not determine who or who not will be saved. He just determines the ways in which we can be saved. Our problem is that since the sin of Adam and Eve, all of us have been born with a bent to self-centeredness. We want things our way. We want people to do what we want. The world revolves around us. So even our choice to accept God's grace is a result of God's grace. The only way that we can say yes to God is that God has rehabilitated our hearts and our lives through the power of the Holy Spirit and given us the ability to say yes. Otherwise, we'd all be lost in our self-centeredness, serving the greatest Trinity that most of us know, and that's me, myself, and I, instead of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So even our choice to accept God's grace is a result of God's grace. And because of our sinful tendency to put ourselves at the center of our lives, we would never volunteer to choose to live God's way. But God's grace awakens us and frees us to choose Christ. Paul puts it this way: because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive when Christ, when we are dead in our transgressions. It is by grace that you have been saved. And outside of Christ, we are dead. We may appear to be alive. We may go through the motions of people that are alive. We may live a life, but we are not really experiencing the fullness of Jesus. We are not really living into who God created us to be. We are merely existing. The only way to truly live is to find our life in Christ. Dead people can't take initiatives. Dead people can't do much of anything. But the living God took the initiative to love us. And we don't need to twist his arm to love us. We don't need to do anything for God to love us. God just loves us. And there's nothing that we can do about it except embrace that love. And when we embrace that love, we begin finding ourselves moving into the fullness that Jesus gives to us. From the very beginning, he loved us. And his grace frees us to love him. Christ gives us freedom. And outside of Christ, there is only slavery. Slavery to sin. Slavery to death. Slavery to self-centeredness. Slavery to inflicting harm upon other people because of our sinful actions. We talked about last week that sin does not have to be the grandiose things that we think of. It doesn't have to be the big things. It's small things. It's that life that says, I'm the center of my universe and I'm all that matters and nobody else does. And the only reason why anybody else is here is to help me feed into my ego and help me to become the person that I know that I am. And so everyone becomes tools. And when everyone becomes tools, then people can become carnage. People can be seen as less than us. And we see a lot of that going on in the world today. Think about all of the things that have happened within the past 2 weeks with people who saw other individuals as nothing other than carnage, less than, and they picked up a gun and they saw fit to kill other individuals because of self-centeredness. But self-centeredness, as I said last week, could lead us to cheat on a spouse, to cheat on our taxes, to tell a little white lie, to do those things that really continue to help us move forward, help us, get what we want in life. But Jesus has so much more for us. Jesus has so much more for the world. The world is sinful. The world is broken. That's why we have all of the things that we have occurring in the world, because we live in a broken and a sinful world. But Jesus stands in the midst of that sinfulness and that brokenness and says that you don't have to be sinful. You don't have to be broken. I love you, and I gave my life so that you do not have to live in that manner. You can live in opposition to the ways of the world. And from the very beginning, from the very dawn of time, from the creation of the world, God loved us and continues to love us, and through Jesus has provided for us a way to rise above the sinfulness of the world and the sinfulness of our self-centeredness and find hope in Jesus. So won't you choose to love Him? Put your sinful ways behind you and live for Him today? That is the question that is at the beginning of every single day. Will you wake up today and choose Jesus? Jesus has chosen you. And every single moment of every single day is a choosing of Jesus. And we have to continue to choose that way of life, because if we don't make that conscious decision, and then guess what? Self-centeredness will begin to creep in, and we'll find ourselves doing those things that only benefit ourselves and those around us. But Jesus says, choose life. And it is an everyday choice. Choose this day. And then the next day, choose this day. The words of Joshua ring true every single day. Choose this day whom you will serve, whether it be the gods of the land around you, the world in which you live, or whether it be God. But then Joshua resigned himself and he took a stand boldly and publicly when he said, "But as for me and my house, we choose the Lord," because that is the way of life. Sin is great, but God's grace is greater than that sin. Choose life, and then share that message of choosing life and help others to choose that life as well. God's love is vast. His grace is unimaginable. It is so vast and so encompassing. And He extends that grace and extends that forgiveness and extends that hope to each and every one of us. Let us live for Him this day. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray. Gracious God, we give You thanks for all that we have heard today. But we pray that it will not just be words that we have heard, but it will be a way in which we can begin to believe in Your grace that frees us, that enables us, that calls us forth. So we pray that what has been said with lips we may believe in our hearts, and that what we believe in our hearts, we may practice in our lives through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we stand and sing our final song, I trust that you will truly make this a time of commitment. Maybe you need to commit to professing your faith in Christ for the first time, saying yes to Jesus. Maybe you need to come back to Jesus. Maybe you want to join this church, uniting in membership and fellowship with this church. Whatever it is, I encourage you to do so as we sing our final song this morning.
I'll sing with us this final song. Great is Your faithfulness, O God. wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart.
This table, why don't y'all come over here? This is a whole family affair. We have Cherry Miller, and she is the grandmother of Kaya and Caden. You saw them just a couple of weeks ago as they joined. They were a part of the confirmation class. She is going to join in membership with us today. She and her family have been such a wonderful part of our congregation already. She comes to us from another denomination, has been baptized, has been part of another church. So I will just simply ask you the membership vows of the United Methodist Church, and that is this. Will you support the United Methodist Church, uphold the United Methodist Church by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? All right. Lord, would you pray? All right.
The opportunity again to just welcome your people to your fold. God, thank you for the grace that covers each one of us and the peace that passes all understanding. God, may we seek to live into that peace this week. May we seek to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Thank you for opportunities to share you with others. May we go in peace this day. Amen.
Amen.
Awesome.
Yes. Yeah.